experience of the limits to growth of 1972, models which are a bit complicated tend not to be believed by those who should instead try to believe them. That, I hope, is a good introduction to World Package 3.
There are three models, a world model, a European model, and something like an average country model or something like that. This model we are developing with Sustained Dynamics methodology, maybe you know. And we have a small experience in another model, world model, that we have developed before. We call Walling, and this is the starting point of the new MEDEAS model that we are already developing now. Indeed, in the next session we are going to explain this model, so if you have time, it will be nice if you can hear this explanation of the model. And maybe if I can say a main characteristic of this model is that we consider several limits for sustainable development, limits about the fossil fuel reserves, gas, oil and coal, but also the limits for renewable energies. And of course, we have to consider all about these CO2 equivalent emissions and the all, of course, of the sources of these emissions. And, well, we have already now a very small version, a more or less previous version of the world model. And our next steps will be to develop the European model and later the country level model. That's more or less all.
Work package 5 is the cross comparison of the different models. As Jordi and work package 4 just introduced, we have a suite of different models that we are using in the project. And whenever we do modeling, we know that the models that we produce are just one of the possible interpretations of reality. So it is always very important to try to relate this possible futures that we present to something that people can relate to. So the work package 5 is the cross comparison of these different models, and we are going to start by, first of all, qualitatively compare the different models, so the structures, what some of the models do. Obviously, we've got different levels of analysis. We've got the global level, the European level, and the average country level. So we're going to run this comparison between different models at the same level. And then we are going to run the sensitivity analysis on the model, because we know that, again, models are very sensitive to different parameters, so we want to explore that uncertainty as well. And finally, we are also going to try to bring together all the output that has been produced so far in the project by taking the scenarios that have been produced as part of Work Package 3, that Ugo introduced before, and the output from the models from Work Package 4, and cross-compare them and see do they fit together, do they portray the same future, if not, why? And then we are going to feed this information to Work Package 6 and 7, which are the barriers and the different policies that we can implement.
We are more or less near the end of the line of our project. It means we are taking the scenarios that have been developed in Work Package 3 and being quantitized with the Work Package 4 and further analyzed in Work Package 5. And we are looking at what does it mean, because the outputs of a model, of a scenario, is a huge amount of numbers, but between the numbers, there are quite a lot of information, and we have to look into that. What do these results really mean? And we are looking at these results with a focus on the infrastructure, like electricity grid, natural gas grid, transportation efficiency. We are looking at it also from the perspective of costs, like energy costs, raw material costs, but also social costs, environmental costs, climate costs. And finally, based on the scenarios, the output of the models, and the findings we have for the costs and the infrastructure, we will also see what challenges and barriers we can identify based on all these outputs.
So we are responsible to implement the result of the project. The main directions of this policy that project is devoted, they are two. First one, the top priority, this is efficiency. Efficiency of use of energy, and particularly electricity. And second one, this is the use of renewable energy sources. So we have to convince, we have to compose a such a structure, regulatory conditions that will support the transit to this low carbon economy that we are targeting. It is difficult to say, but all countries in the European Union are working more than 20 years in this direction, and the results are not so significant. Thank you very much.
We have also some task of creating a stakeholders board in which you are included as well. And this board aims at assisting the project by reviewing all its main outputs when needed and giving us some feedback on what could we do better, but also supporting us in some policy issues. Then, as you probably know, this tool that we are creating will be open source and free. And one part of the work packets will be to translate it into Python and upload it in the website for everyone to have access on it. And also this work packets includes the creation of a user's guide for the tool. And that's all more or less the things that...
I'm Luka Hrčka from Charles University and my background is economics. And basically, I'm interested into this project mainly because I also work with energy models. I'm developing the times model for the Czech Republic. And that's why I'm here. So I have this view from the times modeling perspective. And I hope I will learn a lot of information about your project and hopefully it will be beneficial for also me and you. So here is just a few slides about me. It's my research project participation. Now I'm the main investigation in the project from the Czech Technical Agency that's dealing with the times modeling, and also currently I'm involved in one project from the Czech Science Association from GACHER. So I can say you a little bit about the times model I'm now developing that should be ready in May this year. The model will be updated to 2015 data, and it's quite unique maybe due to the fact that there is real plant level data of each facility included in the EU ETS sectors. And lastly, we also extended the transport sector, included all, or not all, but basically quite a lot of amount of technologies for the cars. At almost 150 cars types in the model now. So that's shortly and briefly about me. Thank you again for your invitation.
Okay.
So I'm going to present the situation of model, also taking as a reference the last presentation in Barcelona. I'm going to start by an overview of our work in Work Package 4. Then I'm going to make a short overview of the wall Medea's model to remind everybody the different modules and the philosophy. And then I'm going to go module by module reporting the new advances and the new changes that we have integrated. And then I will finish with a summary. So in this working package 4, we have these different tasks. And the first one is this global model that I'm going now to present. In terms of deliverables, we have to work with this global model, which the deliverable is by this April, and the European model by the end of this year. And now we are fully working on the global model. Sorry. Much better. So Medea's model is modular. The idea is to develop the modules so the it's like a puzzle in a way that if someone wants to develop a module, this can be done more or less independently and then be connected to the rest of the structure. And also this modular structure is also it's easier for the development and for understanding the functioning of the model and for updates and etc. So we have these main six modules. The one module for economy, the energy, materials, land, what we call environment, or is for rather climate, and social module. So this is like the core of the model. With the economy module and estimates on population, there is an estimation of energy consumption required. So this is a demand-driven model. This consumption required is compared with the energy supply availability, which is an outcome from the energy module. And this comparison is going to tell us the level of energy consumption. So this energy consumption by final fuels. And from here, this is the core variable that relates with other modules. For example, climate model, the energy consumption and the mix of this energy consumption is going to tell us the level of CO2 emissions, and this, the way we are modeling the damage function, the impact of climate on the society, it's under development, I will explain later, through an assumption on the additional energy required to adapt to this climate change. Another important module is the materials, which you can see that it has several feedbacks and relationships with other modules. For example, we need energy for processing materials, and we need materials for producing energy. And also here, very important, the module is, well, here is not a module, but we could say it's a module for the energy infrastructures. Then we have the land use module, which is connected, for example, in terms of requirement for food, with the economy and population and diets. It's also connected with the energy, because for renewable, the renewable energies are very land intensive. They have a very low power density. And also it's connected with the climate module, mainly due to the land use change emissions.
And the last module we are integrating is the social indicators, which, as you see, these arrows, dashed arrows, indicate that we are still working on how to define these social indicators. So the idea, the main idea, is the social indicators will be outputs of the model. Okay. So before entering module by module, I have a couple of slides I would like to share with you about the modeling strategy we are following in the group, because it's very complex model with very different modules, and we need to organize all the tasks to do. So for each module, it's very important to have in mind that there are five steps. First, there is a first step, basic, which I call it analysis. So this analysis consists of analysis of data and acquiring knowledge to be able to know how to model. So how to model at the end is to find causal relationships between variables. When we know how to model, then we are ready to insert in the model, and this means to model that part and to link with the rest of the environment of the model. And at the end, we need to perform a validation. And this is important because many things cannot be validated until all the modules are not built, because due to the many feedbacks involved. And of course, in parallel, we have to document all that. So, because I say it's very high complex model, the strategy we are following is we have to start from a core, and once this core is robust, we can expand it, start to expand it, because we need to be sure that the structure works fine before expanding it. If not, the errors or the improvements are very difficult to find. Yeah, so basically we need to rank tasks. And we have a lot of work in parallel. For example, I'm going to show later the result of the model with input-output tables for 35 sectors. But there was one of our colleagues working several months with a smaller version with only 4 sectors, because you can understand that 35 sectors is very big to understand the connection with the rest of the model. So in terms of timing, we started with energy, with volume as a starting point, and later I'm going to develop, and economy. As I showed at the beginning, like the link between energy and economy delivers the energy consumption, which is the core of the model. And we have adapted the global input-output table from WIOD to be linked with the rest of the model. And we have also estimated the final energy intensities by sector from WIOD. I will talk more about that later. So once we have done that, we are working with the climate impact, because we raised the point before that without integrating climate impacts, the model is not going to be consistent. So for us, it's really a priority after energy and economy. In parallel, the material module and social indicators, as I said, because we are thinking more of reporting outputs, is going to be along all the time development of the model. Once we have climate impacts and materials, we will introduce the climate submodule, and we will model land use. This organization is mainly due to our time constraints in the group. We cannot work everybody in all in parallel. We cannot. So we have to set priorities. Okay, so now I'm going to start module by module about the current situation, describing the current situation of MEDEAS, and I'm going to emphasize the new advances we have introduced. So for economy, We have implemented the YO, the input-output tables. So we think it's a better way to represent the structure of the economy than, for example, aggregate production function. So that is the main reason we wanted to introduce input-output tables. But of course, this introduced a lot of complexity in the model. And I was reading this review of macroecological modeling, and the integration between system dynamics and input-output tables, everybody says, is very promising, but it's very hard. And very, very few people are doing that. In the review, they review 25 models, they only find two examples of this. So, I mean, this is an area very new, and it's for this reason it's so complex. So this database has a multi-regional input-output table for 42 countries. Time series from 1995 to 2009. 18 cloud social and environmental accounts. The environmental accounts, we use them for the final, for calculating the intensities, the energy intensities, and it's open source, so it is compatible with Medeas. So these are the 35 sectors included in the wild. So you can have an idea of the level of disaggregation that we will have in Medeas. I don't know, for example, agriculture, hunting, forestry and fishing, transport equipment. For example, for transport, we have four different sectors. Education, etc. It's a great disaggregation, great level. So this is the conceptual of, I'm going to start for every module by the figure like that, which is a conceptual description of what we intend to use. This doesn't mean that this is already implemented, but just to remind and explain the philosophy and the approach. So as I said, it's a pity this doesn't work, I think. No. Well, so there's a model-driven, demand-driven model that starts with estimating a trend demand. And here you can see input-output tables and the energy intensities. We estimate the expected production. And this is confronted with the energy supply availability. And once this is confronted, we come back estimating again the trend demand of the next period, taking into account the structure of the economy and the energy intensity of the economy.
No, it's integrated in the computer.
Uh-huh. Ah, great. Where did you press? Oh.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. Okay, much better. So, yes? Yes. 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 The energy intensity is transforming the data, the variables in monetary value, dollars, to energy value. So when we put here production, this production, expected production, is monetary. Energy consumption is energy. So the energy intensities allow us to transform between that. And the input-output table allows to transform from production to final demand. So I'm going to explain later, I have the equations. So the main performed task has been to adapt this wild to be linked with the energy module. And for example, we had to calculate the tables in constant prices to transform from multi-regional input-output tables, so 42 tables for each country to a global table, and this was done with Masaryk University, and estimating this trend demand, the driver of the model. This is ongoing work because it's more complicated than expected. And for example, for this version, we have a very simple assumption, but Jaime, a colleague, is working on this. And this estimation of final and primary energies by sector, what you, Jordi, just mentioned, that was also a very long and complicated work. So out of these advances, because I don't have time to enter into details of all the changes. So for each module, I just have selected a couple of them to enter in more detail. If you are interested in other points, we can discuss it later, or we have also documentation. So the estimation of final energy demand trends, we have for every sector, so 35 trend demands. And then we have also to estimate for households, and we have to estimate for non-energy use. And for example, this is a bit the idea. These are results from Medeas, like from, this is the historical period. So you can see that the curves doesn't follow, that are not like continuous. Then there is a trend. This is the trend demand imposed. But if there is no available energy, this trend is modified. So this data is not from the real Medeas model. I mean, these were made up data to produce the figure. But then I can show you real results. Another example, I would like to explain a bit very roughly the estimation of final energy intensities. I'm going to see it better. By sector, no? What is final energy intensity? It's just the final energy by type of fuel and output, so per sector. Yes, and WIOT didn't report the data as we need them, so we needed to think how to adapt them. So for final energy, we are considering for Medeas these five fuels: electricity, heat, liquids, solids, and gas. So we have 35 sectors for five energy fuels. Pues that's the number of final energy intensities. The problem is that WIOT included double accountability in the database. So we need to go to the original reference, so to the International Energy Agency balances, which have much more disaggregation. They have over 60 products, to go back one step and to go forward, thank you, to calculate that. And also, it was necessary to modify the total output to have the values, the production in constant prices, to transform to global tables, and to aggregate the tables to obtain final demand and total intermittent consumption and total output. So there are very interesting results, but I don't have time. So I'm going to show just a couple of examples of the final energy intensities by sector of electricity and liquids. So this is the graph for electricity. This is the historical period of WIOT from 1985 to 2009. And this, every line is a sector of the energy intensity, which is exajoules per dollars of constant dollars. So the first remark, I think, is to see that they are quite stable over this period. And for example, in the case of the electricity, the sectors that have the higher energy, final energy intensity, is the electricity, gas, and water supply, basic metal and fabricated metal, and other non-metallic minerals. In the case of liquids, we find also that most of the intensities for each sector are constant. We have some cases that decrease a bit more, like water transport or coke, refined petroleum, and nuclear fuel. This is just to give you a hint of the kind. This is after is inserted in the model.
Okay. So this is a bit what I say, like the final energy intensities per sector are relatively stable, and the analysis of the coefficients of the matrix A of the input-output tables also show this relative stability over time. So in this model version of MIDIAS, we are assuming a constant both of them. So this is the question of Jordi. This is the equations. A ver. So this is the D is the final demand. This is the final demand. This is the matrix of coefficients, and like that you get the production by sector. So this is already the real MIDEAS. It's not a conceptual overview. And here we have the demands by sector, 35 sectors. This is programmed vectorially. I mean, here we have 35 sectors. And these are the demand of the households. And here we get we cannot read it very well, but this is real final energy by fuel already. And with the energy intensity, we get this. And we are assuming in this model version that energy scarcities, when they appear, they are shared proportionally by sector. So there is no any sector that takes everything and other sectors that fall. In this model, just because it's simpler for us at this stage, it's proportional. This, of course, may change. So ongoing and next developments. So I said the demand function is, Jaime is working on estimate robust and efficient regressions. The integration of technological change. This is, for the moment, we are considering constant the energy intensities and coefficients. So we are thinking how to integrate this technological change. This is very complex and it's also very novel topic in literature. I mean, there are almost not examples of this. So we have to think about a new methodology to do it. And it's complex because it relates the evolution of the coefficients of the input-output and the evolution of the final energy intensity. So if we modify one, the other will be affected, and we have to modify that in agreement with the rest of the MIDEAS model. So this is also, we are thinking about it. And then other potential interesting effects to include will be to integrate, for example, the rebound effect, because we talk about efficiency, but if we talk about efficiency, we should talk about rebound effect to be consistent. And the integration also of demand management policies. Okay, so economy, as you've seen, we have been very busy with this in the last months. So this is the conceptual overview of the energy sector. So this is the net energy consumption required from the economy. Now we go to the other side. And here, at the end, we have this means new renewable, non-renewable energy limits and renewable energy source limits, which are affected by different factors. Technological change tend to mitigate these limitations. And then we have the availability per type of source. And of course, this availability is also affected by energy infrastructure. And the ROA, at the end, is an output of the model. Here is because it's a conceptual overview that is not so clear, but ROA will be an output of the model, not an input. Okay, so the submodule of energy MIDEAS starts from volume, and we have made many improvements, and also it has required to make modifications to adapt to the rest of the MIDEAS framework, to the rest of the model. So in particular, we have introduced more depletion curves of non-renewable energy. So I will show you later in the Excel. We are making an effort so the model can be run by modifying a lot of hypotheses. So one of it is to choose which depletion curve of oil, coal, gas we introduce to run. We have modeled the capacity of renewable energy infrastructures. We have included more resources. So now we have wind, offshore, and conventional gas. We have estimated sustainable biophysical potential of non-electric renewable energies, which in Wellington there was not. We have somehow, for this global version, included the factor of the intermittency of renewable energy source for electricity. So I think I'm going to explain that a bit in more detail. It's a rough estimation because at global level it's very difficult. At European level, we might do something more specific. And also consistent behavior and their production reductions. Okay, so first example from the energy module, the modeling of the capacity of energy infrastructures. So before there was just a representation of energy supply. The scenario was to increase the energy supply per type of technology. So advantages. There are some advantages that are obvious, like in reality, first there are the infrastructures and then we extract the energy. This allows also to consider the planning and construction delays. Like when we decide to produce new energy, first you have to plan and then construct, and there might be a time, a delay in everything. There is a close relationship between infrastructure and materials. So if we are modeling materials, we need to model the infrastructure. This allows also to better estimate the investment costs. It also allows to better integrate the overcapacities related with the intermittency of renewables, of some renewables. Okay. So this is the loop diagram of the renewables for producing electricity in Mideas. This again is vectorial, so there are seven technologies, so every variable there is vectorial. So here we have this is for example new plant capacity. This is the plant capacity in a moment of time. This is the new capacity under construction, which is given by the time required for planning. Then we have the capacity in construction. And then we have finally the new capacity installed, the capacity that is producing energy. Okay, before there was just one stock and flow. And of course, this is better to see in the model, but the real generation is the minimum between the demand and the capacity. I mean, what you can produce given your capacity. So this is just a small result. I was curious to see how this affects to the delays. So I made two runs. This is solar production, terawatt hours. This is time from 1995 to 2050. And the blue line is assuming that there are no construction, no planification delays, zero. And we reach here. If we consider that the time planification and time construction is, for example, 6 months, which is a reasonable value, we get this 21% difference by 2050. So, I mean, this is a typical thing that until you don't model, you don't realize how important it is. 6 months, it doesn't seem, I don't know. My intuition was like that. Okay, a second example, how we have integrated the intermittence of renewables for electricity. Because before all technologies were assumed to contribute to the mix, assuming output average and optimal capacity factors, and so on. So the methodology we have followed, there is a study from, an agency focused on renewables in the States. Now I don't remember exactly the name, but they studied for electricity, the mix, assuming different rates of penetration of renewable technologies in the electricity sector. So this is You can see here the different technologies in color, different colors. This is the percent of renewable energy by 2050. So here we have a baseline, 30%, 40, 50, until 90% penetration of renewables. And this is the energy, well, the share, the mix. And this is the installed capacity. And here we can really see that the introduction of intermittent renewables needs huge levels of overcapacity. So in the baseline, with below 1,000 gigawatts, it will be enough. And when we increase the penetration of renewables, we need extra additional overcapacities. Okay, so we took this study as reference, and I built the following curve. So you can make a regression, or there is a relationship, the more penetration of intermittent renewable energy in the system, the capacity factor of the base load plants, the plants that can be regulated, decreases. I mean, they have to adapt when there is wind or solar, they switch off, and when there is not, they switch on. This means that they don't work at optimal capacity factor. So the efficiency of the system decreases. So we have estimated this, this relationship. And this is result from MIDEAS, what happens? This is better again to see it in the model, but used to, so when you see this in the model, you can understand what is happening. This is capacity factor of the different renewable technologies. I'm sorry for the quality in the computer is much better. This is the capacity factor. So those plants like geothermal, biomass and waste, and hydro that work as base load, when the intermittent renewables increase their share in the mix, their capacity factor decreases. This is also a very interesting effect. And there is a also this with the modeling of capacities, there are synergies and trade-offs with this, interesting. What is this is what I just was saying. Why for this? Yes, because they have to adapt to be able to be ready when there is no wind and solar, which are the typical intermittent source. So that means that they cannot work all the time. So that means that their capacity factor decreases. And their time of functioning is more reduced when there is more capacity of intermittent. But you have to be ready to cover when there is not. That's the reason. This is output, this is input. This blue curve. Also important to have in mind that this is for the global model. For when we go to a scale more reduced European, for example, we can think about grids, for example, because for intermittent sources we are going to need to build more grids. But at global level, we think that this is like a rough approximation and we cannot do much better. But if we go downscale, maybe we can complicate a bit more with more data. Okay, so the current status of the energy module, let's say, is very advanced, but we still have some important things missing. We have to finish the linking between final energy fuels from MEDEAS and the primary energy fuels original from Walling. So this is not still done, mainly because it's technically easy, but we need to have the data on this. And this is what is going to require more time. We need to finish the infrastructure module in the sense that we have done the electricity renewables, but we can apply the infrastructure for any a facility producing energy, so this for the moment is not done. It will be also interesting to link policies to exogenous variables that now are exogenous variables, but they could be maybe endogenized. Like in the previous session, these carbon emissions maybe could be exogenous driver and the currently exogenous assumptions on growth of different technologies could be endogenous. This could be done, but again, we will need time. Yes, so this is, and then we need to, of course, if we don't have material module or land use, we don't have the links. So this will be done when these modules are finished or in development. So this, so okay, economy and energy, let's say, as I said in the beginning, are the two big modules we have been working this month. So the next modules, I will be faster. For materials, the idea is quite simple because energy consumption requires materials and material consumption requires energy. So then how to model that is complex, and we are now starting to develop this module. So if you remember the steps I was mentioning, we are still in the first one, analysis, how to model. And here it's important also, for example, to account for policies on recycling, because in the energy you cannot recycle the energy, but the material you can recycle. So this is also interesting. So about the climate module, we have two main ongoing developments. So I mentioned before, like, first one is to integrate a simple, what is called a simple climate submodule, and to integrate the impacts due to climate change. So you see that the idea of climate module we have is something like to consider the land use change emissions that will come from the land module, and the CO2 emissions from the energy use. The climate submodule will transform this into concentration and temperature change, and then we will feedback the impact. Here the arrow is in temperature change. Now we are testing with concentrations, and maybe we will try relative forcing. So this is, we still don't know, it's under development, but this is the main idea. So the idea of integrating a simple climate submodule, the main objective is to have a consistent integration of different greenhouse gas sources, because now we have CO2 emissions from fossil fuels, but we know that there are a lot of much more emissions from nitrogen or methane or land use, etc. And we have also sources of radiative forcing that are not driven by emissions. So the idea is to try to have all. However, this is not the objective of MEDEAS. I mean, climate models can be very complicated, and we don't want that this part is too complicated. We just want to integrate all the different greenhouse gas sources. So the methodology we have followed is to revise the existing climate models to see which one could be integrated in the framework. So we came out with five candidates. I guess you have heard something about some of them. So the two versions of DICE, the free model, the C-ROADS, and ESTIMO. Well, I'm going to enter in details. I mean, if you are interested, I can tell you, or we have more documentation. But at the end, we choose C-ROADS for this reason, because it's a fast, small, we call small and simple. It has 8 stocks. So ESTIMO maybe has 100 stocks already. So this was already too much. I mean, it will be bigger than MEDEAS. Ah, magic, it's true. License. Yes, this is a list of... Yes, yes. And good news, like, we contact the authors and we have the explicit authorization, and it's already a model already developed and fully testing system dynamics. So, I mean, is like for us the best option. So the current status is we need to do the work, to do the adaptation to Medea's framework. But this in any case is not priority as explained at the beginning because it's not the core of the model. Well, this is just an overview of this C road. So you can, this is the simplified carbon cycle. So you have here carbon in humus, biomass, and sequestered, and this, the balance between these three gives you the carbon in the atmosphere, and there is a exchange between the carbon in the atmosphere and the carbon in the oceans. And then with this concentration from here, you come here to the climate part and you estimate the temperature increase. Okay, the second big part in climate module is the estimation of climate impact. So I'm going to be a bit faster here because this is the slides that Luis Javier presented in Barcelona. So, and it's the thing of the consistency of the models. If we don't integrate this, we come out with scenarios that are not consistent, and we think that this will be a problem with the, also for the communication of results. I mean, why politicians also is difficult, because we are showing them business as usual, where the GDP is growing until for the next 100 years without action. So if I am a politician and you tell me that, I'm not worried. If I see that my world, I believe that GDP per capita is the driver, I mean, it's an indicator of well-being, and this grows, climate change is not so important. So we want that our model in the business as usual is not going to give so optimistic outcomes. And it's not because we want, but because it's consistent with the scientific literature of climate change and environmental impacts. So just to refresh your memory from Barcelona, what we are using now, but this is under development, is a function that assumes that when the CO2 concentrations increase, we need to dedicate more energy to compensate these impacts of climate change. So we are assuming that at pre-industrial levels, we don't need to dedicate anything because the climate is stable. Well, not stable. It's not affected by humans. And we need to dedicate all our energy use when the level of climate change reaches a very dangerous value estimated by scientists. Of course, this is subject to a lot of uncertainties, but we have initial point, end point. We know we have to go somewhere here. Okay. So when we introduce this in Medea's for these parameters, this is one of the curves I showed before, the pink one. But the model is robust to the others. Well, I don't have time to enter into it. These are the energy losses due to climate change, which by 2050 they reach less than 6%. It's not enormous, it doesn't seem enormous, but these are the results we obtain with Medea's. This is new from Barcelona, because we have changed the way of integration. So, if let's go one by one. The red, this is global GDP. If we consider a scenario with unlimited fossil fuels, non-renewable energies, without damage function, we obtain this increase of GDP growth, even if the concentration and the climate change goes worse. Okay, this is the most of the models operate with these assumptions, especially until 2050. What happens if we introduce restriction to fossil fuel extraction in the model? We obtain this, what I call reference scenario. This blue dashed line. So this growth, this difference is not possible because there are no non-renewable energy fuels available. But what happens if we include the effect of climate change impact? Here we go. As I said, this of course is dependent on this.
And our idea is to make a kind of sensitivity analysis or something to estimate this, but this is very time consuming because, again, it's very new. And for the moment, it works, but our idea is to develop further. Okay. Okay, next module is land use. The land use module, as we see it, should cover two main objectives. The first will be to estimate the land use change emissions that should fit the climate module. And the other main objective is to be able to account for land availability as a potential restriction for renewable energy sources. And especially we focus in biomass, solar, and hydro because they are not compatible with other uses. Wind, you can put windmills and you can have agriculture, but solar is almost incompatible with other. Theoretically, no, but practically, yes. So this is also results from Medea's for a set of scenarios. This, I didn't say, this set of scenarios are like Jordi explained, the SSPs. It's a translation we have made to be able to run a range of scenarios with the model when we develop it. So in different scenarios of this is the current land dedicated for urbanization and infrastructure and so on. And if we account for the land use requirements of renewable energy technologies, we see that all of them require land higher, and for higher scenarios, even double. So it's relevant to include in the model. This is for now an output, but when we have a land module, this will be consistently modeled. Because maybe this is incompatible with feeding all the people with the current diets, but now we don't know because we don't have this land module to confront the land availability with land demands. Sí. Now, yes, this comparison is just to give you a feeling of what is this, because if I tell you 700 mega hectares, I mean, I myself, I'm not aware. Yes, this is the conceptual idea we have for the land module. It's not, it's a simplified model, but it's not, for the moment, a fit with numbers. So we will have agricultural land, we have urban land, desert, land for solar, land for biomass, forest, and there will be shifts between the different uses, but the total amount of land, of course, will remain the same. This will depend on population growth, GDP growth, diet change. These are scenarios. If we, in a scenario where we consume less meat, there will be agricultural land free to be occupied by forest, which is the sequestration technology of carbon, sequestration of carbon technology we have in Medea's, or for installing renewables. And it will be very interesting, but we don't know if we will manage to do it, to integrate the climate change impacts that will increase the desert land, for example. Okay, and the last module is social indicators. So as I said, yes, social indicators, I mean, Medea's is, doesn't include all the factors upon the social well-being of people depends. So it's impossible in this framework to estimate variables depending on culture, depending on education, on health, etc. But Medea's can assess some social indicators and provide like estimates, for example, in the case of energy, I will enter after in detail, like without energy consumption, you cannot have some needs covered. So it can provide some minimums. So the different modules come here to the social indicators and we estimate some indicators. Okay, so these are examples of indicators that now Medea's report, like as Epi said, like
with GDP per capita, emissions per capita, total and primary fuel, and by primary energy fuel supply per capita, final electricity, number of people relying on traditional biomass, this kind of information. Future developments of the model might include what we will see, equity indicators, employment, welfare, water per capita, land per capita. This can be done with WIO, the satellite accounts, environment accounts, etc. And that, then there are other social indicators that will be easily implemented in the European model, like, for example, jobs related with the energy transition and so on. And here I wanted to give an example about how this could be useful. The relationship, for example, between total primary energy supply per capita and well-being. So the literature says that there is a relationship between energy use and well-being, in a sense that the energy consumption is a condition, a necessary condition, but it's not the only condition. So without some levels of energy consumption, you cannot cover some needs or some demands. So I selected here two thresholds. Like if we want to cover just basic standard of living, food, housing, clothes, etc., the threshold might be around 40 gigajoules per capita. But if we would like to satisfy the way of living, our way of living, of, let's say, industrialized, advanced countries, or if you want HDI over 0.8, we will require a total primary energy footprint of over 100 gigajoules. So footprint means that we account for the energy used by in other countries to satisfy our needs. Okay, so it's the discussion Christian was raising before, the difference between demand and footprint. Okay, so we have like 40 and double, more or less. What is the model now reporting? This is a mistake. So again, we have the five scenarios I'm all the time representing, and this is a threshold of 100 gigajoules. This is a threshold of 40. Currently we are here, and the different scenarios report that we are going to have a similar level or decrease a bit. So this is just, again, output and comparison with literature. Of course, this is related with inequality. Now we could satisfy, in theory, this level of consumption, but it's not like that because there is inequality. So maybe an interesting input, but this will be probably, well, we can discuss that, but it will be exogenous, will give us how many people are consuming this energy with this kind of curves. For example, it's just an idea like that we have. Okay, so if we come back to this slide we had before, because now I talk about all the models like that, but I try to put in one slide the current state of development of MEDEAS. So for each model, there is going to be four flags, four boxes. If this part of the analysis of the development is finished, it will be red. If this one is finished, the second will be orange, the third will be yellow, and the fourth will be green. Okay. So this is the current state of development of MEDEAS. Like, I hope it's not confusing. But for example, for the energy module, we have finished the first step. We have finished the second, how to model. And this lighter color means that we are working on the validation and the implementation. For materials, we haven't started. I mean, we still don't know how to model, and so on. So as you can see, the energy and economy are the most advanced modules. The social indicators depends on the development of other modules. For land use and climate model, we know, we have analyzed, we know how to model more or less, but we have to start to model. Okay, so here, until now I have talked about the development of the model, but in parallel we are working in the documentation, so we already have a draft for the deliverable, but it's a live document. We have an Excel interface to work with Benzim. How many people did successfully install Benzim Reader? Uh-huh. Great. Most people. Okay, so you have seen then that there is an Excel file, and in principle you can run scenarios without entering Benzim. Benzim do the calculation, and you in the Excel you change the number. So maybe, I will show you the results of Mideas in the hands-on session. So all this I will show you in the hands-on session later. And just to summary the ongoing and further work to conclude this session. So we are trying to include all the significant and available information. The main problem is time. We have to, in theory, in 2 months. The energy module as well, the connection energy economy is working. This is very good news. And all modules are still being developed. So I talk about materials, land use, the climate, and we still have to validate the model, which is very important step, but and will require time. But we need to finish before most of it. Okay, I think this is the most important. Thank you.
So just tricks like changing the time step or the integration method or whatever. Then there are some other methods of validation that maybe is the thing you are thinking about to compare with the other results of other models of other authors to see the difference, and not only the difference but also the reason of this difference. Why we obtain, if it's the case, different results to other authors. Maybe you are thinking this kind of validation. Okay. Yeah. So, yeah, for this kind of validation, I mean numerical and so on, for example, a basic method is also sensitivity analysis. If we find a small parameter that is very sensible to the results, we have to doubt about how the model is. Indeed, while programming, we show some of these clues to see the robustness of the model. So this is a set of techniques for validation. And not for validation only, but also in order to compare results with other people later. I don't know if this is the question you...
Yeah, but okay. So I was just wondering, are you planning to do it in Word Package 4?
Yes, in that we call the extension of Word Package 4. The extension of Word, that may be in April, May, something like that. No, in May, June, because you're right, we have nearly no time. We have accumulated delay because several reasons, including the some difficulties with data.
So, but about the energy module, I was just not thinking. Like, maybe you are wondering how the allocation of different technologies is done and all that. Okay, so this now, as it is done giving priority to renewables and equally. And because the growth of each technology is exogenous input. So when you set up the scenario, you say
to impose that solar is going to grow at a solar capacity is going to grow at a 10% per year, 20% per year, wind 15 or 40. So for each technology, exogenous technology, you put up, you put this exogenous growth, and then the model evolves. But we know that this is not the best option, and we are thinking how to make better an allocation between the different technologies. I forgot to mention that, yes.
So does it mean that there are some cost connection to the external technologies? Or does cost doesn't play a role? And yeah, and my further question was actually to the technological change in the input output model. How does it function actually?
The question there is basically which type of production function to set up for this, and this is still very much open. We are having debates about what detail of prices we should consider, if prices at all, and what type of effect prices have on the composition of sectors in the input-output matrix. And yeah, and this is still very much open. And depending on which variables are available in the system dynamics model, that could have an effect on the technology in the sector. So this is not yet defined. And so if you have any ideas in this for linking input output with system dynamics through any functional structure that is not, say, a constant elasticity of supply or a translog function, then this would be a good information for us.
So I don't have such an idea at the moment, so the price does not play a significant role in the model. So there is some feedback of demand for the energies. That in general there are expectation that the energy will be the prices of energy will be higher. So is there some reaction of the demand to it, or is there some change of technology in your model also in the household? The suppliances and technologies on the demand side? Okay, so you have constant, basically, demand intensity.
Call them five representative scenarios. So these representative scenarios are basically a business as usual, which is an extrapolation of current trends, and then four alternative scenarios. Usually, these assessments organize these four scenarios following two axes. First axis is what they call regionalization versus globalization. So, is going the world to evolve in the future? I mean, is possible to a more globalized situation, more free trade, less borders, etc., or maybe the world is going to evolve. This will be the Trump also scenario, or Brexit regionalization scenario, more borders, less trade, everybody tend to focus more local. This is one axis, and another axis is the balance between pro-economic growth, so the priority of governments is economic growth at any cost, or more pro-environmental protection. Let's protect our environment before we get their impacts. So if you organize these four scenarios in these four two axes, you get four different storylines of four different pathways, qualitative. For example, the scenario one is more globalization, pro-economic growth. This is the typical scenario promoted by international agencies like OECD or things like that. A scenario, for example, three will be regionalization and more economic growth, for example, burning unconventional oil, gas, etc. Okay, so this is what you are going to find in Mideas. Five scenarios, BAU, scenario one, two, three, and four. So remember this, yes?
Well, this is only examples of scenarios. In this case, we use the war scenario like an initial input for the running the simulation, okay? So this scenario is a set of maybe, let's say, 20 parameters to define the conditions. On any parameter, you can change, of course, and you build your own scenario that is something between scenario 3 and scenario 4 you want. And the other thing you can do is a sensitivity analysis, as we were talking before, for one scenario. If you say, okay, scenario BAU will be a economic growth with a rate of 3%, but you can do a sensitivity analysis with a plus minus 20% over that. So you will see how BAU will be like a range of values possible. You can do the same with any of them, of course. This is more or less, okay.
Okay. So just this for starting. I mean, because we have so many variables, this is a guide to create the scenarios, consistent scenarios. We could design a scenario varying different parameters, but maybe this is not consistent. This is just a way for consistency. Okay, so now I propose to go to the model in VenSim, and when you open with VenSim Reader, you will be opening two files. So let us know if you have any problem. I'm going to open the VenSim Reader. You do open model. You open model and you look for your a VPM file. Ay, mierda. Okay. Do you see this? Okay. So I recommend to go. Just simple explanation about VenSim for those that are not familiar. If you click here where it's written CP, DCP is control panel, social indicators, this will appear. And this is an index of all the windows that are views that are that form Mideas. This is just a way to structure the model because everything could be modeled in the same window, but then it will be a bit chaotic. So every name is a description of what is modeled in that view. For example, and
Well, sorry, and there are two parts. Here starts structure, and here in all this is structure until control panel results visualization. So the model is this structure part, and from control panel and onwards, this is just visualization. It's just to have to understand the scenario. It's better this than to go window by window checking different variables. This is something that we have prepared. Maybe there are some variables that are interesting that are not here, but we can add them. Okay, so to run the scenario, we just have to press here, simulate. And now I hope it works. Okay, it's running. Here we are. Okay, so let's go first to the structure part. I'm going to explain you rather quickly the structure of the model, and then I will show you, or we will see together, the results, and then I will show you how to run scenarios. So, for example, this is the tab view population. As you see, it's very simple because it's an exogenous assumption for each scenario. So you can see here that there is not much variation. This is mainly due to inertia in population. So when you go, there are different views. You can go to the different views with, how do you say, page up, page down. It's easier than go to here and select. So you just try with page up, page down, you can move easily. So for example, this is the integration of the input-output tables, the generation of the trend demand, monetary and energy. You will see that in some windows there are graphs to help understanding that window. This will be non-energy use demand. I'm going to be quickly, I mean, this is self-explanatory, you can understand alone. This is the electricity demand. This is the electricity generation by renewable energies. This is the electricity by fossil fuels. This is nuclear. This is losses. This is biophysical potential of renewables for electricity. For example, just to give you an example, this is, for example, the maximum potential for hydro. So you want to see the evolution of a variable in the model, you just press select this variable, you go here to the side and you click on graph. Okay, this is not surprise because it's a maximal potential, so along all the period, this is constant. And this is 0.75 terawatt electric power. And it's the same, in this case, it's the same for all scenarios. Of course, this could be modified. I will show you later how. Maybe I can show you more interesting variable. This is the capacity of renewable for electricity that I showed in the presentation. For example, if you want to represent this variable, installed capacity, renewable energy, you click here, they will tell you, the benzene will tell you only the first 16 variables of 35. Why 35? Because we have seven technologies and six, seven scenarios. Should be 36, no? Well, so it's going to show you some of them, but it cannot show you everything. So, sorry. Yes. So this is not very useful because there is too much information. So what you can do is to go here to subscript in the corner. And here you will have all the variables that are vectorial. Are you following me? No. More or less. Okay, start that part. Here, subscript.
And here we have variables that are vectorial. For example, scenarios. Scenario 1, scenario 2, 3, 4, BAU, business as usual. Here we have the 35 sectors. Here we have the technologies, electric technologies. So if we want to visualize just one technology for one scenario, then we should select here. For example, none. For example, we want to see solar. And we want to see only for a scenario 2, for example. You close, and then you can graph. And then we have just one curve because it's solar for the scenario 2. And this is installed potential, installed capacity. So like that, you can play to visualize the results. You select which scenario you are more interested. You can compare scenarios. You can compare resources. You select what you prefer. So in this scenario, the solar capacity grows until more than 10 terawatts and then stabilize, probably because the input parameter for the potential, which for solar is the land availability, is, there is no more free land. Let me find that. So you see this variable, max solar on land. You see that it is 100 mega hectares, the assumption. And if you go, we have a window for land, which is here, surface solar, you graph it. So it's not the land availability, but probably the electricity demand. Okay, maybe I'm going too deep with this example, but so you can see what kind of things you can do to understand the model. So, okay, so I continue. Here we have, this is a, once we know the capacity installed, we can now estimate the monetary cost that this will require. So here we have the balancing cost, the grid reinforcement costs. So we have an estimation of the additional investment to cope with intermittency. For example, this should be dollars. Why? So here you can see, mierda. So this is for the scenario 2, because I didn't select. We will need 3 teradollars. This is dollars power 12, 10 power 12, to have the estimate. This is the estimate on traditional biomass. This is land dedicated for biofuels. This is other kind of resources of biomass, like for example, cellulosic, like third generation. Of course, this is related with the technology disaggregation. This is heat. This is the supply of renewable energy source, not for electricity, which is model, it should be model like taking into account capacities. This is still to be done. So we have just one stock, but we will need to have these 3 stocks, as I showed before. Well, there are some windows that are just like aggregating data or creating average or something, is for that I don't enter into details. Like this is, for example, a window where the different sources of renewable energy are added to have so traditional biomass, thermal, biofuels. Yeah, in the full version of Benzim, for those who have it access to it, you can click in each variable, then you see the equations behind that and a commentary that explains what is this variable. So, ¿cómo se dice? Opposite of hopefully, I mean, here we cannot see it. This is transport demand. This is the different technologies for transport, hybrid vehicle, electric vehicle, natural gas vehicle. And this is already extraction of non-renewable resources. So I forgot to say something important. Like all the windows of the model are connected. So here you see, like, it looks like this variable is not affected by anything, but in fact, this variable is coming from other part of the model. So how we can see that? We click here, and here there is an option called causes tree. A ver. And here you can see how this, where this variable comes from. So total oil demand is comes from other liquids extraction and total demand liquids. And these variables come and you can go backwards. Okay. This is oil extraction. This part here on your left is conventional oil. And this is unconventional. So, a ver. Here we aggregate all the demand for liquids from different sources. You can see, for example, for heat here, for electricity, etc. This is the total demand, and we compare this total demand with the maximum extraction availability, which comes, it's an input from the scenario. And then you can see if the demand is fulfilled or not. Layout, no, view, zoom, and you select the... So for example, if you select both extraction and demand, you can do it holding shift key. Then you can compare the result of two variables. For example, here we see that in this scenario, scenario two, the demand and the extraction match all the time, for example. Or you can compare, for example, the total demand of liquids with the extraction of oil. Okay, so now most of the demand, liquid demand, is covered by oil, but this difference is growing, and this is the demand of liquids, and this is the part covered by oil, conventional oil. So you can check whatever. You can see also in the other side here how much is the extraction of unconventional oil in this scenario, for example. Bueno, these steps shouldn't be there, but because it's under development, it's allowed. But the behavior is okay. Okay, so after oil, gas is modeled in a very similar way, conventional and unconventional. This is coal. This is uranium. This is coal to liquids and gas to liquids, like production of liquids from coal, production of liquids from gas. And this is already like calculation of the total primary energy supply, adding the different sources, extraction of gas, extraction of oil. So this window is not doing nothing especially, like just aggregation. This is the result I showed you before, the estimation of the surface required by different renewable technologies. I'm going to come back to show all the scenarios. Okay, this is emissions, and this is climate. So for example, you can see that in these scenarios, this is line is the 2 degrees. So in all the scenarios, we get over the 2 degrees. So these scenarios, even if they are very diverse in the policies, we can see that their impact in terms of concentration is not so big. The dispersion is really, the spread is really like reduced, maybe 20 or 30 ppm. This is the energy. These are the energy losses due to climate change that I also explained in the presentation, that are estimated here but affect the energy demand, the energy consumption per capita, and that's all. That's the model. That's current state of MIDEAS. All the next windows are just reporting of results. So I don't know if you have any question of hundreds of questions. All clear. Let's go to... I think you have to explore it, and any question while we are here, it will be the easiest, and if not, email or whatever. For running scenarios, it can be done through the Excel, sheet. This is, for example, the input for the scenario 2. So here we have business as usual, scenario 1, 2, 3, and 4. These three tabs here, economy, constant, and parameters, are variables that in principle are not modified in the scenarios. It could, but as it is now, built or constructed, no, but this is easily modified. Anyway, for those who have, you don't have the full version of Benzene, which I imagine you are the majority, we have built this tab, which is like the others, but it's an empty tab, which in every cell, instead of providing numbers for the scenarios, it provides the description of each input variable. So this, when you want to run a scenario, you have to read this carefully, because of course the name of the scenario, the name of the variables in Benzene are not going to tell you exactly what that variable means. So for example, this variable is called P variation trend demand. This is what you see in Benzene. Let's find it. P variation trend demand. For example, you can do it like that. Edit, find P. What was the name? I forgot. A ver. P variation trend demand. So you find it, okay, and the model will bring you where this is, this variable. So you in Benzene, in principle, you don't see if a variable is an input from a scenario or not. but if you go to Excel, you can check. So this variable here is a variable from scenario, okay? But when you see in Benzim, you don't know what is this variable doing. So you have to go here to Excel, and then you read trend demand of each scenario in relation to past trends for all 35 wild sectors. So this is a parameter that modifies the trend demand. The trend demand, final demand of per sector. Is it clear that? And here you can graph it to see who it is for each scenario. So for example, the gray scenario means that this is like past trend demands because it's one. And if it's 1.5, it means that the trend demand is increased 50% in relation to past trends. In the scenario one, here, scenario one, blue line, 1.5, for example. So here you can see, well, there are holes because it is in development, so we have deleted some, we are all the time changing it. So here, for example, you can change. Sorry, this is the description. This is, for example, techno-ecological potential of electric renewable energies. And here you have maximum for hydro, maximum for bioenergy and waste, maximum for oceanic. Here you have the units, and here you have the description. So when you go to the scenario, for example, this is the business as usual scenario. For this specific scenario, we have this set of inputs to run the scenario. The potential for hydro is, for example, 0.75 terawatt electric. We could check that. Let's find this variable. So the name here and the name in Benzim is the same. For example, edit, find. Here. We graph it, and 0.75 for all scenarios in this case. Okay, I have the feeling I'm talking too much, so I think the best is that you try to run scenarios. So the way I recommend you is that you can preserve this business as usual, scenario 1, 2, 3, and 4, and you can make all your modifications in this tab called user defined. Okay, the model is also running with this tab. You just have to select it here because it's not showed by default. In the scenarios, if you see here, the user defined is not selected. So you select it, and now you can here modify anything you want and run. Yes? Yes. Yes, they are completely independent. If, for example, you want to compare your scenario with scenario one, you just fill the data in your scenario.
Parameters
This is constant. For example, the typical constants, a conversion between units. I mean, this is not going to depend on scenarios, how many exajoules there are in megatol.
Mm-hmm.
For example, one parameter, the... Yes. It will not work because the Venn sim has for every variable. We are telling Venn sim to look into inputs Excel in the tab scenario one. So if you add one new tab, five. Yes. Don't change the names of these tabs. It will not work if you change the names, yes. Better. So, for example, I don't know, in this user-defined, typical easy values to modify. This is the, for example, the growth. This is projection. Electric renewables, the growth for each technology. For example, this P solar, annual growth per year. So this is 15% of annual growth of solar for this scenario. So if instead of 15, we want to try, for example, 25, you just write it, enter, and then you run the model. I recommend you to run under another name, for example, two, not to write the previous results. Simulate. And now I'm going just, because I just made one modification in user defined, I'm going just to represent the results of user defined, not to get confused. And now, but then. A ver, this is solar, a ver. And solar, because I modified the growth of solar. I'm going just to represent user defined and solar, the installed capacity. Why there are four? Ah, I didn't delete one scenario, sorry. I forgot to unclick like that is okay. Graph. Okay. So we have two different lines. This red one is by the default scenarios. I mean the original, the 15% growth. And this blue, that I changed the name default scenarios to, is the growth, annual growth of 25% per year. It behaves like that. So like that you created your mini first scenario. Mm-hmm. Yes, the thing is that there are limits from very different sides. Maybe I should show you the results of the model. Yes. Yes, I should have showed that before, I forgot. But just an overview on what kind of
results we are getting. Yes. Okay. So this is first window, population and GDP per capita. So population, as I said, is exogenous. So for each scenario, it follows a trend taken from the global environmental assessment. I mean, this is not a very original from our side. And this is already the GDP and the GDP per capita. So this is just this divided by this. So this have the same information for each scenario. So this is very interesting because it already accounts for the constraints on energy resource availability and climate change impacts. So for example, we can see that for a scenario, for example, green, the green scenario, scenario three, is a scenario of regionalization and pro-growth. So this, following the model, is the worst scenario in terms of GDP. Doesn't mean that it's the worst scenario, because this the growth or decrease or recession, it can mean very different things, this reduction of GDP. And for example, for a scenario one, is a scenario of globalization and pro-growth. So that means that in a future, hypothetical future, of more growth, more trade, we extract unconventional resources to the limit, with, of course, we get later the impacts, we will manage to sustain the growth of the historical rate growth, let's say until 2030. Then there is a period of stagnation, and then they decrease. Yeah, so these results, I mean, because of the many feedbacks, they are a bit, let's say, complex. And for example, there is one variable where you can deactivate the climate impacts. For example, if you want analyze or see the effects or just of energy constraints. Then I will show you later that. But I'm going to advance a bit to show you the results of the current version of MIDEAS. Okay. So this way will be the evolution of GDP. This is the primary energy demand intensities by sector, which is not completed because in theory, we have 35 sectors, but here, just to have you get an idea, I have represented the electricity, the transport, and this is the total primary energy consumption intensity. So you can see that depending on the scenario, depending on the introduction of new technologies, there is an improvement in this intensity. For example, here in the case of transport, it's very interesting. You have two scenarios. This is three and four, where the intensity remains very constant. But in these scenarios, it decreases. This is due to the introduction of electric vehicles, they have a better primary energy intensity. And here the same. Depending on the scenario, this is an output. I mean, this is not an input. This is the output of all the technologies, all the changes implemented in the scenario. Bueno. For example, this is the electricity sector. This is the demand, the generation. They have too much. This parameter abundance, you will see that it always should be one. It's for us like, this is because it's in development, so we need this kind of testing. So this means that the electricity demand and the generation match. Okay, so if you see this variable, just means that this is equal to this. So that means it's good. The electricity generation from fossil fuels, this is your question from before, you see that, let's say that for most of scenarios, if it's not zero, it's close to zero by 2050. From nuclear we model a bit different because we impose exogenous scenarios, but we always give
a priority to renewable energy sources. Of course, if you have less renewable energies, this green line, the fossil fuels will be used more time. I mean, in this sense, it is consistent. For transport, the same. This is transport demand, transport supply.
Perfect.
Total primary energy. Here, there is a discrepancy. We will have to check this. This, I think, it's an error, no, Nacho? I mean, it should be the same. It's hit, okay. Yes, what I said, that in this, I mean, in Mideas, the supply should always be equal to the demand. So this is telling us that something is not good. And Nacho now said it's because of something. But... Yes, but you are not going to see it here. Yes. No. This is a problem. The model is not. Yes, we have some. I mean, we didn't finish. This is good, and this is means that there is something that is not related to transport, because transport is good, that is not good. Okay. This is the short explanation is this, but I recommend you to go to the original paper of Wallin, because we are using the same scenarios, and I recommend you to read this part. I mean, to have more details on what do we mean. Here, we have preserved the same names because it's the same storyline behind. Now, some hypotheses that fed, I mean, we are not using exactly the same, but the same idea. So here you have scenarios and policies, and you have a description here, scenario 2, scenario 3, scenario 4. And for example, for this paper, we, for each scenario, different input variables. Okay, but the table is here not so important, because some numbers have changed and now we have more variables, but for the description, it's better if you come here. So your this is for the scenario.
Thank you.
Yes, it's clear.
For we can give to the model input like a value or a time series. In this case, we use time series because we are using a population evolution from Millennium Ecosystem Assessment scenarios, from image. So the inputs we are using the same. So this is the reason. I mean, we didn't made up this estimation, but we use another estimation, and it's a time series. I continue a bit with the overview. With the overview of results, this is the total primary energy. So, ah, no estáis viendo. Stone energy. ¿Cómo hago esto? Okay, so what is telling us Medeas in aggregate up to now? That now we are consuming around 500-600 exajoules per year, and depending on the scenario, we have different trajectories. So, in, for example, in for scenario one, we could increase the energy consumption until 2030. Of course, this is related with the GDP evolution. And for some, and then decrease to, for example, the scenario one to current levels. Other scenarios increase a bit, then more decrease. So I think for you, the most interesting will be to modify in the Excel and see how these outputs change or doesn't change, etc. Okay, this is the extraction of liquids, coal, and gas for each scenario. Well, this is the result for liquids with more disaggregation. Bueno, liquid demand, liquids extraction, this is good. Conventional oil and conventional biofuel, CTL, gas to liquids. So the addition of all this is liquids. So you get the disaggregation. This is oil, natural gas. Okay. For gas, at the moment, we only have conventional and unconventional. We should add biogas. And this strange here behavior, it's just because in the Excel, you can choose if the available curve to use is conventional gas, unconventional gas, or all together. So in this case, we are using a curve of, this is also a bit strange. We are using a curve that only includes, that includes total gas. So this means that this is historical data, but here, this is because it includes also conventional and unconventional. I mean, for now it's a bit strange, but it's consistent because of the way of introducing inputs. Let me show you this because it's important for running the model. So here you have different parameters, and you have to put a number often, and here you have the units. But for example, for curves, we haven't made up any estimation. I mean, we have reviewed all the literature, and we have introduced curves into the model. So this is what it means. I don't know if you can read it. Okay. This is from a paper from Maggio, and they have, because it's three estimates, middle, high, and low. So this is, if you see the number here, 1, 2, 3, and 4. Selection of conventional oil curve. So when here we put 2, this means we are assuming
the conventional oil follows this availability. We put one, then it will be this one, three, etc. And we always have added a user defined, so if anybody wants to try another estimate, he can add it. And this is in this cell, 93A.
Should be there now. Or where is this? Fuera. ¿Dónde está esto, Nacho? 97A. Pero this is all, esto ya es user defined. A ver. Ah, here, but se ha movido. Okay, this is it, but the name doesn't match. But this is a detail, I mean, it's possible to introduce a personalized hypothesis. And here, for example, we can also test unlimited gas, unlimited coal, unlimited uranium to test the model, to see what happens. And here the same, you have a selection of total gas curve, selection of unconventional gas, conventional gas, etc. And here is what you say if your estimate has conventional and conventional aggregate or not. So separate conventional and conventional gas. If it's zero, it means that you are not separated. It means that everything is aggregated. Okay, so I can. Yes, it's what. Okay. It's because the availability of gas in the model, we assume a curve that includes both conventional and unconventional. Again.
Okay.
This is not that the extraction of unconventional gas go to zero. This is not real. But it's the way we are reporting now this that we know that this is not good, but it's how we report.
So this difference here, this is unconventional gas. So here, where it's written conventional gas, in reality is conventional and unconventional.
I mean, I know it's confusing.
But it's confusing. It's confusing because it's not well reported.
The next meeting it will be better. Yes?
No, no relationship with that. More questions?
Okay. So coal extraction and demand, the evolution. This is uranium. Okay, this I'm not going to explain because there are some problems here, minor, but that are going to confuse you. The abundance. Okay, this is the remaining potential of renewable energies. This is interesting. Because as we install more renewables, we get closer to their limits. So this indicator of remaining potential, one is full potential, zero is all potential is used. So it's giving us indication of how much we are using.
So in these scenarios, for example, this is for electricity, we will be using around half of the potential by 2050. And this is renewable energies for thermal uses, not for electricity. So for biomass, for burning biomass, biogas, solar, thermal, things like that. So for example, in this is, in, we see that in some scenarios we use all the potential. This of course depends on the growth rate in this scenario. This is renewable window showing results for renewables for electricity. This is generation. So we see that it increases for all the scenarios between 4, 5, 6 times. This is also interesting. This is the share of variable intermittent between and base load electricity generation. So this is something we have to check because it seems a bit unrealistic that by 2050, because we give priority to wind and solar, all the generation is comes from wind and solar only. So we should have an hypothesis, an assumption on some base load minimum capacity. This is the, in terms of cost, share of GDP versus the investments for renewables. So it can reach 6% of GDP by 2050 for all scenarios. This is this but cumulative. This is the abundance of renewables by technology. So it's just detailed results. The previous window was aggregated results. So this is for hydro. This is the graph I showed in the presentation, like the abundance increases because the capacity factor decreases. And for example, for wind and solar, because we give them priority, in some scenarios, they use all the assumed potential. This is solar on land. And this is the total energy supply. Again, I always divide, we always differentiate between renewable for electricity and non-electricity. So we could have total primary energy around between 150 and 200 exajoules per year, which is rough, doesn't reach half of the total primary energy supply by the 2050. This is the results from land use that I already showed. And this is what we call social indicators. This is what we have until now. GDP per capita, CO2 emissions per capita, the figure from the presentation, average total primary energy supply per capita, and so on. So I know it's a lot of information. So the next step will be to, if you can create some scenario and try to compare your results with the by default scenarios. That would be the interesting part. Do you feel motivated?
Last 2 minutes.
The last. Not in the Excel, this will be in the thing, in the report that is in construction. That's the only exception, yes. But you don't know, I mean, nowhere is written La Ferrer 2010 exactly
I mean, there is not a list of reference. But all this, all the energy module is documented in technical report that I could distribute already. I mean, most is documented. And I forgot to mention here, you can also modify parameters from the climate module, like climate sensitivity, for example. And here you can activate or deactivate these impacts. I recommend you to see what is the influence of this function that we are using.